The natural world is full of beautiful, vibrant colors, from birds of paradise to the other kind of birds of paradise. And as well as being stunning, a lot of these colors evolved to serve a purpose, like how the neon colors on a poison dart frog scream, "If you eat me, you'll be sorry," or how a male bird's plumage entices mates to come hither. But this brings up an interesting question. If no animal had eyes capable of perceiving all of those colors, why would colorfulness evolve in the first place? And if no life was super colorful, why would we evolve color perception? Is this the next big chicken or egg question? Well, one pair of scientists has already had a go at figuring out which came first, colorfulness or color vision. There's no one way to be colorful. Bright, iridescent, color-changing, you name it, the natural world probably has it. What you, or a bumblebee, or a SciShow's unofficial dog Perry see as color depends on a couple of things. First, there's the actual production of the color. Some color comes from pigments, molecules that absorb certain wavelengths of light and reflect the rest. This is, for example, how adult flamingos get their pinky coral color. Pigments called carotenoids in the shells of yummy yummy shrimp wind up settling in their feathers. But color can also have a structural origin. Sometimes a material has such a weird shape on a microscopic level that sunlight reflects off in a way that produces a new hue. This is how a bunch of life produces vivid shades of blue, from the scales on a blue morpho butterfly wing to the carefully arranged collagen fibers inside of a mandrel's snout. Meanwhile, some animals combine pigments and structural color to get unbelievably rich greens, reds, and turquoises. But all that light bouncing around also has to be perceived for it to count as color, and how animals see color comes down to their physiology. Take honeybees, for example. They can't see what we define as the color red, but they can see shades of blue, green, and even ultraviolet, thanks to the type of photoreceptors they have in their eyes. Color perception also depends on the type of light-sensitive proteins inside those receptor cells, which scientists call opsins. And finally, the last piece of the puzzle is the brain, and how it decodes all of those incoming signals. So combine light, receptors, opsins, and a brain, and you've got the magical world of color. But why does color exist? Or rather, the rainbow of colors you find in living things around the world? Well, in a word, signaling. The male Wilson's bird of paradise has vibrant patches of red, blue, and yellow, as well as iridescent tail feathers, which can be seen easily on the dim forest floor. Those flashes tell the much duller by comparison females, "I'm here, I'm healthy, and I'm awesome." On the flip side, some species of octopus can change their color in order to blend in almost seamlessly to their surroundings. And so on and so forth. We can only provide so many examples in a 2100-word script. I'm sorry, I have not brought up your favorite colorful animal. They all are cool and have good reasons. But color and color vision must have gotten here somehow. So what evolutionary forces got us to where we are today? Well, in a paper published in 2024, two evolutionary biologists tried to find out. More specifically, they wanted to figure out how and why conspicuous colors exist. Vibrant colors that help organisms stand out, as opposed to the greens, browns, and grays that help them blend in. They started out with five hypotheses for what came first and why. One, that it evolved in fruit first to attract animals to eat them and spread the seeds inside. Two, that it evolved in flowers first to attract pollinators. Three, that it evolved as a warning. And four, that it evolved to attract a mate. The fifth hypothesis was that color vision evolved before any and all of that. To test these hypotheses, they reviewed and combined the results of previous studies in order to construct their own evolutionary or phylogenetic trees, and then tracked the history of all these functions. Where possible, the research duo backed up these reconstructed trees with evidence from the fossil record. Then they lined up all of those reconstructions to compare them all on the same timeline. They were especially looking to reconstruct what the evolutionary order of events looked like. That would tell them which trait is the oldest. However, this was not a perfect approach. Evolutionary tree reconstructions have their limits. The further back in time you're trying to go, the more uncertain your model. And evolution doesn't just tick steadily along. Sometimes traits spring up really quickly, only to disappear just as quickly again. Or you might have a similar-looking trait show up in multiple species all at once. That makes it hard to definitively say that the common ancestor of both organisms X and Y had trait Z. Plus, with color, you have the added complexity that it doesn't stick around well in fossils, so it's tricky to bolster a speculative tree with hard evidence. But despite those shortcomings, evolutionary trees are still one of the best approaches we have for understanding the past. But before we get into that research team's results, we gotta keep the lights on with an ad.
This SciShow video is supported by Incogni, a company that uses technology to boost your data privacy. Incogni wants to prevent identity thefts and scams, and those are things we also hate. Their goal is to keep you in control over your own personal data, because it's yours. Like, your addresses, your political beliefs, your property records, and your financial data. The thing is, total strangers, including scammers and cybercriminals, can find all of that stuff online. That's why people turn to Incogni. Incogni can help remove your personal information so that your privacy can be, you know, more private. To check them out, you can use the code SciShow at incogni.com/SciShow or click the link in the description for 60% off an annual Incogni plan. As part of that plan, Incogni will contact more than 270 data brokers on your behalf to request that they remove your personal data, and they'll keep it up with repeated removals. Plus, their new custom removals feature in the unlimited plan lets you request data removal from almost any website. And you can sign up for their family unlimited plan, which makes sense if you're worried about data like who's in your family becoming less private. After all, privacy. It's fun for the whole family.
Okay, so remember when I mentioned the bird of paradise with its dazzling colors to attract a mate? Well, it turns out that whole shtick is a relatively recent thing. According to two surveys this 2024 paper reviewed, creatures attracting mates with flashy hues only showed up around 100 million years ago. That's solidly in dinosaur territory timeline-wise, so it might not sound recent until you realize that life of any kind may have existed as far back as 4 billion years ago. After reconstructing different potential versions of family trees, the researchers found that color for mating evolved mostly in two key animal groups, arthropods and chordates, better known as the groups containing spiders, insects, and centipedes, and the group containing everything with a spinal cord. To find out how far back this kind of coloration went, the research duo looked for cases where the males and females were sexually dimorphic, meaning there were obvious visual differences. And during their hunt through the evolutionary trees, they identified some fish from around 97 million years ago where the colors were probably different. But when they dug through the fossil evidence, they did find one outlier, a feathered dinosaur which lived around 160 million years ago, called Anchiornis. This fossil was preserved with a tuft of red plumage on its head, and paleontologists think that these red feathers were used in mating displays. It's a case that highlights how color can pop up at any time, only to disappear with the species' extinction, leaving no trace in today's animals. But let's move on to our next kind of colorfulness. If the most recent development of color was for getting other animals to come hither, then the second most recent was for kind of the opposite. Coloration as a warning sign, also known as aposematism, may have evolved around 130 million years ago. Based on previous phylogenetic studies, the authors of this 2024 report think it probably evolved in insects first, and maybe in the ancestor of particular butterflies and moths. But that would only put the start date at around 105 million years ago. Meanwhile, looking at the fossil evidence, they identified an ancient Lebanese cockroach preserved in amber that had distinctive warning coloration, and it is 130 million years old. Now, their paper did point out one study from 1998 which suggests some Cambrian fossils were iridescent as a way of warning. For those of us who don't have the geologic timeline memorized, the Cambrian was around 500 million years ago. But even if you count iridescence as a type of colorfulness, which these researchers really don't, the link between color and aposematism in this case is, quote, highly speculative. So let's take another step back in time, and we see that color starts showing up in flowers somewhere around 200 million years ago. That's when the oldest angiosperms, or flowering plants, start to lure pollinators with vivid hues. And some of those pollinators got turned into fossils with little bits of pollen still stuck to them, backing up the estimates based on evolutionary trees. But insect pollinators like beetles and flies were already buzzing around before this point in the timeline, and were instead drawn to an older group of plants called gymnosperms. Instead of seeking out colorful bouquets, these insects were going for appetizing-looking fruits. Gymnosperms don't develop real fruits like angiosperms do, but they can have seeds covered in bright, fruit-like flesh. Such red, yellow, and orange feasts date back to the late Carboniferous period, between 307 and 299 million years ago. Meanwhile, some of the most ancient groups of flowering plants, including the group that now contains water lilies and the group that contains star anise, had fleshy fruits too. There's some debate about how old those ancestors are, but most of the studies and fossil evidence the authors reviewed put them in the range of 200 to 250 million years ago. So of all the stuff this research duo looked at, that makes fruits the oldest conspicuously colorful thing with a purpose out there. But when did life develop the ability to see any of this? It turns out, way earlier, like hundreds of millions of years earlier. According to the author's research, color vision may have been around 550 million years ago, but reaching that conclusion wasn't as easy as it was for the other hypotheses. After all, you can look at a plant or animal today and see that it's colorful. But how do you know which animals have color vision, let alone what it actually looks like for them? Think back to when we were talking about photoreceptors and opsins. It's probably a good idea to start by checking if the thing has those, but not all opsins are involved with vision, so that's not enough. In currently living species, scientists can also use behavioral tests, like the gray card method. Basically, animals are trained to associate a certain color with a food reward, then they're shown a set of gray cards and one color card and asked to choose. If the animal still picks the colored card, then that should mean they're able to see that color. To find the origins of color vision, the research duo started with a fairly comprehensive review of modern animals from 2003, which concluded that lots of arthropods have color vision, as do many a chordate, from ray-finned fishes to birds to, yes, mammals like you. The researchers then looked at the evolution of all of those groups and proposed the first case of color vision likely evolved in an arthropod ancestor, which lived around 550 to 500 million years ago. But why would it need that color vision, or the first chordate, to evolve their own version? Why did life manage to evolve color vision before the colors they might want to see with that vision? Well, first of all, it's not like the Earth was in grayscale for billions of years. Water is naturally blue. The sky was a shade of orange for a while. Rocks have minerals that come in a full rainbow of colors. Plants are green because of the chlorophyll they use for photosynthesis and so forth. So maybe color vision just made it easier to recognize objects and better navigate the world. In fact, in a paper published back in 2000, one scientist suggested that color vision might have made it easier in general for ancient marine animals to see in shallow waters. In that particular environment, beams of sunlight will travel through ripples on the water surface and create continuously flickering high-contrast patterns on everything they bounce off of in the water. And if everything is always looking a little bit different to your primitive eyeballs, that kind of makes it hard to avoid the predator that's trying to eat you. So color vision may have helped dull down this contrast and smooth out what an animal could see. In other words, it may not have evolved for life to see color at all. Ultimately, the science behind all these hypotheses is a little imperfect, and until someone invents a proper time machine, we may never know the exact evolutionary play-by-play. But for now, the question of which came first for color and color vision really does seem to be a chicken and egg problem, because the first egg got laid way before chickens existed, even if you only count the ones with shells. I guess the real question is, what color was that eggshell? And was there anyone around who could tell? We'll be right back.